we pray. Amen and amen. Put your hands together one more time for Jesus. Put your hands together one more time for Jesus. We thank God for this music ministry, for these musicians, and we thank God for our video technician. But I just want to let you know that God did it again. He did it. He did it again. He did it again. He did it again. Somebody needs to know that God is undefeated. He's never lost a battle. He's never lost a case. The Lord is undefeated. He did it again. What did he do? He kept us. He kept us. He kept us yet again. All the stuff we faced and had to fight through. But for another 7 days, the Lord has kept us. And we give his name glory, honor, and praise. Put your hands together one more time for the Lord Jesus. Amen. We're going to go to the word of the Lord this morning. We're not going to prolong the time at all. We thank God for all of you, all of our visitors, all of our sainted members. Thank God for all of you. It's just so good to see your faces today. And I thank God that we've been praying all week long that God would heal, deliver, and set free. And I'm seeing the evidence of it because you're here. You're here sitting in the seat you're sitting in. That means that the Lord answered my prayers. Thank God for Jesus. Amen. We're going to turn in our Bibles to Psalm 124. Psalm 124. I'm soliciting your prayers this morning. We thank God for my own wife, Lady Jessica Clay. Thank God for her. Amen. Thank God for her. Thank God for Mother Stocker, Mother Braxton. Thank God for them, their wisdom. They on point every week. They make sure that they don't miss when they come out the house. They come out the house meaning to do business. Amen. Amen. To all of you, our visitors, just thank God for you. Psalm 124. I'm going to need y'all to follow along with me in the text today. I'm going to need y'all to pray because I just got to give you what he gave me. But I mean to make it through it. I mean to make it. Amen. Psalm 124. Krista, good to see you. Good to see you. Psalm 124. We're going to read the entirety of the 124th number of Psalms. 8 verses there. I wish if you would, in the comment section, put that in there. Psalm 124, verse 1 through 8. When you have it, would you say amen? Look at what the Bible says. If it had not been the Lord who was on our side, now may Israel say, if it had not been the Lord who was on our side, when men rose up against us, then they had swallowed us up quick. When their wrath was kindled against us, then the waters had overwhelmed us. The stream had gone over our soul. Then the proud waters had gone over our soul. Blessed be the Lord, who hath not given us as prey to their teeth. Our soul is escaped as a bird out of the snare of the fowlers. The snare is broken, and we are escaped. Verse number 8. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. May the Lord add a blessing to the readers, hearers, and doers of his holy word. For the next few moments, as you take your seats, we're going to tag this text, which way is up? Which way is up? If you're watching online, I wish that you would put that in the comments section. Make sure that we're all on the same page. Which way is up? My brothers and sisters, Mount Everest, while it is not the tallest mountain on earth, it is considered to be the tallest point on planet earth. And it is said that since 1969, that every year at least one person dies on the mountain trying to reach the peak. And as a result, the path to the peak is lined with the bodies of people who never made it. I'm already preaching. In fact, it is said that over 300 climbers have attempted to scale the mountain and never returned. And since there is no biological life on that level due to the harsh conditions, it is said that the frozen bodies of fallen climbers remain intact and serve as grisly reminders of the dangers of the mountain. But it was in 1953 that two men, Sir Edmund Hillary and Tenzing Norgay, became the first two climbers to successfully reach the top of Mount Everest. And much of the original information that we have about the mountain and its conditions came from their account while they were climbing. But the documentation that they put together, the notes that they took on their journey, I believe will help us on our journey, because here's what they said that was so interesting. They said that the higher they got, that the harder it got. I want y'all to hear what I'm saying. And eventually, when they were on the ground, they read all of the stories and got all of the information from everybody who had gone before them, who had tried to reach the top of the mountain. But eventually, they got to a place past where any person had ever gone. So they got to a place where there was no information there. There was no account was on, what was on that level. And so they got to a place and point where they had to go, not from what they knew, Lord have mercy, but they had to chart new territory. And so they said that the higher they got, that the harder it got. It says that as they climbed, it got colder and colder. And on every level, they said that the terrain got tougher. And at one point, the men noted that when they got past the point of no return, they got past the point of where any human had managed to make it, that they encountered a whiteout blizzard that was so severe, y'all, that they lost sight of the summit. They could no longer see the summit, and they said amongst themselves, because they got confused because the wind was blowing so hard and the temperature had dropped so low and the oxygen is so thin up there, that they begin to wonder which way is up. And so they started looking at each other trying to see the top, and they didn't know where to go. They didn't understand which way to turn, and in their hearts they were wondering, y'all, which way is up. But they noted, y'all, and this blessed me, that the only way that they were able to survive and make it to the summit is that when they could no longer see the summit, they note that Hillary had a handheld compass in his pocket. And when they could no longer see what was ahead, he looked at what was in his hand. Because in his hand, it had one letter on it, and it was the letter N. And the letter N simply meant north. And he said it was a reminder to them that there is no other option but to head north. Because even though it was easier to go back, even though it seemed like it wasn't as tough to stay where they are, he kept pushing forward because the only direction on the compass was north. I hope you hear what I'm saying. And that reminded me, y'all, of another leader who was leading a conquest, and his name was Moses. And if you read your Bible in the book of Exodus, at one point he got to the bank of the Red Sea. And when he got there, God said to him, "What do you have in your hand?" Lord, you got to help me get through it. And the Bible says that he had a staff in his hand, and God said, "Stretch it out." And he stretched forth his hand, and the Bible says that God opened up a path in the sea. Now that's beautiful, that's amazing, but theologians give a little bit more detail to that encounter, because they said that Moses' staff was not just any staff, stay with me, but they said, y'all, that Moses, that every time God did something for him that he could not do for himself, that he marked his staff. So when God would make ways out of nowhere, he would mark the staff. Whenever God would perform a miracle, he would mark the staff. Every time he came under attack and God brought him out on the other side, he would mark the staff. And so when he stretched out his staff, everybody else just saw a stick. But Moses saw every miracle that God had ever performed in his life. And his faith was raised to the point that if God did all of that, surely he could handle this. And the Lord told me to tell you that you got some stuff in your hand. You got some marks in your staff that'll help you move forward even when you don't understand which way is up. But I got to admit to you that sometimes we can get so blindsided by life until everything feels like it's upside down. And sometimes it just makes you wonder which way is up. Now, the children of Israel in the text can understand exactly what it is that we are saying, because if you look at the pericope in the Bible, it says right under Psalm 124, it says the godly bless God for a miraculous deliverance, a song of degrees of David. Now depending on the translation of the Bible that you have, it will say a song of ascent of David. And all it is that whenever the children of Israel got ready to go to Jerusalem to the festivals or to the temple, y'all have to know that Jerusalem was affixed in the Mount Zion. And so when they were traveling to get to Jerusalem, y'all, they would have to climb a mountain to get to the temple. Stay with me. And so they would come from lower elevations and they would walk all the way to the base of the mountain. And then in order to get to the top, they had to climb their way to the top just to get to the city of God. Now, I just wonder for us, because many of us now, we look at the sanctuary, and I understand that it's COVID and some people don't feel comfortable coming into the sanctuary. But I just wonder how many of us, if the church was in the mountain, how many of us would climb the mountain to see God? I just wonder how many of us would look at our own comforts and the things that we don't want to face and don't want to overcome and deal with. How many of us would fight to get to the temple? And I beg to differ. And I feel that some of us wouldn't try that hard, because even now we're bringing it right to your house and all you got to do is log on and see the service. But there are still people who don't log on to have an experience with God. But you got to understand that the children of Israel understood that God was all they had. And that when time came, they had to get to the temple, because the psalmist said, I will look to the hills. Come on, somebody. From which cometh my help, for my help comes from the Lord. And so if you were a Jew, you understood that your help was in the hills. And it had nothing to do with elevation. It was simply that is where the temple was. And I want to talk to somebody who knows and understands that when you've been through a tough 7 days, it's nothing like coming into the house of the Lord and feeling his presence. For I will look to the hills from which cometh my help comes from the Lord. We setting the stage. So now that they are traveling on their way up the mountain to get to Jerusalem, to get to the temple. But the reason that this is called a song of degrees, y'all, is because while they were traveling, they were singing. Lord have mercy, help me make it through this. While they were climbing, y'all, they were praising. The entire time that they were walking, y'all, they were worshiping. And so Psalm 124 is one of the songs that they would sing as they were climbing the mountain to get to the church. Stay with me. And so I want you to see what it says. Verse 1. If it had not been for the Lord who was on our side, now may Israel say. Do y'all see that? Here's the picture. Because the first verse is actually sang by the worship conductor. Stay with me. I got to paint the picture. And so the worship conductor is walking ahead of the people. And they haul out and they haul out and say, if it had not been for the Lord who was on our side, now may Israel say. Now, that ought to make sense to you because we do the same thing now. Because if I were to open up my mouth and say, God is good all the time, somebody will respond to me and say, and all the time God is good. It's called call and response. If I were to yell out, if you call on Jesus, somebody would say, he'll answer your prayer. That's called call and response. Y'all understand what I'm saying? And that's why if I were to look at you and say, look at your neighbor and tell him, and you would repeat what I said, that is call and response. So now David is leading the charge, and he begins the discourse. He says, if it had not been for the Lord who was on our side. Now that ought to bless you, because we know that David was blessed because he was the greatest king ever to rule over Israel. But David said, I want to remind y'all that I ain't the only one who God has been good to. So let me remind you that if it had not been for the Lord, not who was just on my side, but if it had not been for the Lord who was on our side, now may Israel say. I want you to see the picture of it. And so while they were on their way up the mountain, y'all, just like the climbers of Mount Everest, every now and then they would get tired. While they were walking, every now and then they would get weary. Every now and then some people would wonder if it was worth it to make the journey all the way to the top of the mountain. And so in order to keep them encouraged, Lord have mercy, the leader and the worship leader would start this song in order to make sure that they could remember God's goodness to remind them why they got to keep going. If it had not been for the Lord who was on our side, now may Israel say. So while they're on the way up, the psalmist reminds them, here it is, this is point number one, of how God had previously protected them from human enemies. That's point number one, human enemies. Look at your neighbor and say, human enemies. Look at verse number two. If it had not been the Lord who was on our side when men rose up against us and they had swallowed us up quick when their wrath was kindled against us. Y'all see that in your Bible? Now the first thing that stands out about these two verses is that the psalmist, y'all, does not name a nation, neither does he point to a particular people as Israel's attackers. He uses generalities in the verses. So it leaves us as readers to speculate about who the psalmist is referring to. Stay with me. But even though, y'all, David's lack of detail creates questions for us as the readers, his approach was perfect for his original audience. Because we have to remember now that the psalmist is communicating to a congregation who has lived the details, so he does not have to give the details. Okay, all right. Let me put it this way. I want to make sure you can see it. Have you ever seen somebody post something on social media and it almost drove you crazy trying to figure out what they were talking about or who they were talking about? They'll do something like, they'll put like three broken heart emojis with a whole bunch of exclamation points behind it. And then people come in behind them and start commenting. Girl, I can't believe this. Lord, no. When did this happen? And you sit there looking like, Lord, not them, Lord. Lord, not them. And you sitting there thinking, what happened? Who y'all talking about? I mean, 30 or 40 comments, and ain't nobody said no name. That's what I'm talking about. That's Lord have mercy. And then every now and then, some of us, you know, you may happen to muster up enough courage to ask what happened, or to ask who y'all talking about. And then they come back. Folks always in people business. Folks always trying to be nosy. Well, let me just help you. Let me help you so I can help all of us. We all a little bit nosy. Mm-hmm. But since it's first Sunday, I'm going to take this one for the team. We ain't really being nosy. We just want to know. And my question is, if you didn't want folk asking questions, what you put it on Facebook for? If you ain't going to tell us, then don't tease us. Lord, I'm sure going to be, man, who you talking about? I just want to know who you talking about. That's all I want to know. I just had to get that out. I had to get that out. I'm back now. All right, I'm back now. But here's the picture. The person posts something that the general public may not understand. Lord have mercy. But the people responding to it, some of y'all see it, are the people who are connected to it. Because what's understood does not have to be explained. Uh-huh. And that's the technique that David is using in the text. He understands that I don't have to use specifics because the people that I'm talking to are intimately connected to what I'm talking about. But I want to show you. But the core reason, y'all, that David does not speak in specifics is because he is not trying to focus their attention on a particular incident from their history. He was trying to remind them, y'all, of God's entire resume. Lord, stay with me, stay with me. So David makes a general declaration, knowing that they would remember the details. See, that's why whenever we say, God's been good to me, I don't have to tell you specific incidents of what the Lord has done, because he's done so much for me that I cannot tell it all. And so all I'm doing is telling you the best of it so that you can remember the rest of it. Uh-huh. That's what David is doing. He said, I ain't got to tell you every detail of your life because I know you've been good. I know he's been good to you. I don't have to tell you every instance that the Lord has blessed you and opened doors because I know the Lord has been good to you. But I want you to look at, Lord, what he says. I want you to look at what he says. If it had not been the Lord who was on our side, look at this, when men, plural, rose up against us, then they, plural, y'all see it, had swallowed us up quick when their, plural, wrath was kindled against us. Now, I want you to see the beauty of David as a writer, because that's a very important detail. Because the reason, y'all, that David uses the plural forms of these words is to remind the people that it was not just one nation that rose up against us. It was not just one nation that attacked us. It was not just one nation that tried to destroy us, because many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivered us out of them all. He says, I need you to know that it's been more than one nation. And let me remind you, because when we were enslaved by the Egyptians, God got us out. When we were overtaken by the Assyrians, the Lord rescued us. When we were kidnapped by the Babylonians, God brought us back better. And when we were persecuted by the Persians, the Lord liberated us. Now let Israel say, if it had not been, I want you to see the story, for the Lord who was on our side. He's trying to paint a picture for them, because he wants them to be encouraged as they climb. I want you to see it. I want you to see it. Yeah, so the psalmist, y'all, doesn't speak in specifics, firstly because he wants them to remember and rehearse God's entire resume. But there is another reason why he leaves it open-ended. Say, there's another reason. There's another reason why David makes this an open-ended declaration. And that's because even though much of Israel's deliverance was documented, there is still some stuff that God did for you that nobody knows but you. Y'all got to help. That's why the senior saints used to sing a song. He's done so much for me that I cannot tell it all, because there is so much that the Lord has done that ain't even documented. Every one of us has a testimony that we ain't never told. Every one of us has some blessings that ain't even on the books. Every one of us has received a miracle that we ain't never mentioned to anybody. And I believe that when the psalmist said, "Now let Israel say," that everybody begin to recall to their mind what the Lord had done. I want you to see the picture of it. He says, "Now let Israel say, if it had not been for the Lord who was on our side." And in a sanctified imagination, I believe that when he got those words out, that somebody hollered out, "When I was sick, he healed me." Yeah. Then over on the other side, somebody else said, "When I was in trouble, he rescued me." And then way over there in the corner, I believe that as they kept climbing, y'all, that the testimonies, they just kept coming. And somebody else said, "When I was low, he lifted me. When I was weak and weary, he strengthened me." Then somebody way in the back said, "And when I was blind, he led me." Somebody else hollered out, "And when I wanted to quit, he kept me." Then somebody else got the revelation and said, "When others walked away, he stayed right by my side. Now let Israel say." And I just believe you ought to look at your neighbor and say, "He's done so much for me that I cannot tell it all." Now let Israel say, if it had not been. Lord, now that's important for us, y'all, because sometimes we think that if we went through anything, that God ain't with us. But the psalmist says, no, I got to help you understand that the reason you know that God is with you is because even though you went through it, you still survived it. Because if it had not been, Lord have mercy, for the Lord who was on your side, then it would have been worse than what it was. Yeah, I got to help you. I'm trying to get there. I want to encourage you today. I want you to see it. So they're walking, they're on the way up. And the psalmist reminds them of how God had protected them from their enemies. Y'all, but then he reminds them of how, point number two, God had delivered them from natural emergencies. Okay, I'm going to show it to you. We're going to get out of here. Look at verse 4. Then the waters had overwhelmed us. The stream had gone over our soul. Look at the words he uses. Then the proud waters had gone over our soul. Now, I alluded to it a little earlier, but if you know Israel's history, then it makes sense that David would make multiple references to God's deliverance as it relates to water, because the greatest deliverances in their history were connected to bodies of water. So I want to show you, because in Exodus 14, read it when you get home, when God brought them out of Egypt, they came to the Red Sea. And Pharaoh and his army was behind them, and the Red Sea was in front of them between a rock and a hard place. Somebody know exactly what I'm talking about. And the Red Sea was in front of them, and the Bible says that day when Moses stretched forth his rod, that God worked a miracle and made a highway in the middle of the Red Sea. You can't tell me what my God can't do. He literally changed the laws of nature to get his people to the other side. And the nation of Israel, y'all, is the only nation that can testify that they walked on the dry sea floor of the Red Sea. The only nation. Now the reason, y'all, that would encourage them as they climbed is because when God parted the Red Sea, it had never been done before. And so God proved to them that day that even if I have to make a path in the sea, I got the power to get you where I want you to be. That I changed the very laws of nature, even if I got to turn the sky brown, even if I have to dig up the entire ocean, even if I have to push over a mountain, I got the power to do what I want to do in your life. But the reason that some uses the word waters, plural, is because, y'all, in Joshua chapter 3, they came to another body of water, to my Bible readers. Yeah, it's called the Jordan River. Stay with me. And the Bible records, y'all, that when they needed another path in the sea, that God did it again. Lord have mercy. And so the psalmist encourages them by reminding them, y'all, that the only two times in history where water was parted for a people to walk across on dry land, God did it for you. Now, here's why that ought to bless your socks off. Because somebody listening to me right now can testify that God did not just work one miracle in your life, but when you needed another miracle, he did it again. Yeah. I'm talking folk listening to me right now who can testify that you beat cancer twice. Somebody right now who's listening to me, that you've had more than one heart attack and you're still alive. That more than one stroke you had in your life, more than one mental breakdown in your life, you've had the Alpha and the Delta variant and you're still here. But here's your shout. If it had not been for the Lord who was on our side, where would we be? All right, I'm trying to get somewhere. Yeah, he said, I need y'all to understand that he's done it over and over and over and over and over and over again. And if you ever want to almost lose your mind, sit on the side of your bed, get a pencil and a piece of paper, and start writing down every miracle he's done in your life. Write down every prayer he's ever answered. Write down every promise he's ever made. Write down everything that he's ever done for you that you couldn't do for yourself. And I can promise you that you'll praise him right in your bedroom. That's what the psalmist is trying to do. He says, I want y'all to understand that everything we faced could have taken us out had it not been for the Lord. Lord have mercy. Who was on our side. But here's what the psalmist is really wanting to leave with us. He's whether it is evil people or natural disasters, we do not have to live in fear. And we can continue to climb, y'all, because the Lord is on our side. Now, some of y'all say, well, I see what they say in the Bible, but I need you to give me some proof that I can see. Well, I got you. Let me prove it to you. I want to show you something. In the year 2000, walk with me, they told us that Y2K will shut the whole world down. In 2001, they said that anthrax will kill us all. Walk with me. In 2002, the West Nile virus hit the shores of America. In 2003, they said that the SARS epidemic would take all of us out. In 2004, mad cow disease took the entire nation by storm. In 2005, the bird flu broke out. In 2006, there was a nationwide E. coli crisis. In 2008, the housing market crashed, and they said that we would never recover. I ain't finished.
In 2009, the swine flu hit. In 2013, North Korea had nuclear weapons and they threatened to wipe the United States completely off the map. In 2014, it was the Ebola virus. In 2015, ISIS threatened more attacks on U.S. soil. In 2016, it was the Zika virus. And in 2020, COVID came. But that ain't all, y'all. Say that ain't all. That ain't all. I got more for you. Because then, y'all, in the last 20 years, we have endured 11, say 11, of the deadliest hurricanes to make landfall in our nation's history. In 2003, it was Hurricane Isabel. In 2004, Hurricane Ivan hit. In 2005, Hurricane Emily, Hurricane Rita, Hurricane Wilma, and Hurricane Katrina hit, all in the same year. Y'all gonna get it out the way. In 2007, it was Hurricane Felix. In 2016, it was Hurricane Matthew. In 2017, Hurricane Irma, Hurricane Maria, and Hurricane Harvey hit all in the same year. Tell your neighbor, but that ain't all. That ain't all. That ain't all. Year to date, y'all, in California alone, there have been 7,758 forest fires, and they have estimated that it has burned over 2.4 million acres of national forest. Not even to mention the fact that there have been 1,980 mass shootings in the United States in the last 10 years, of which 525 of them have happened in 2021 alone. Y'all gonna get it. And even though, y'all, that ain't all of it, that's enough of it to show you that every year for the last 20 years, we have seen sickness, natural disasters, and disease. But like the psalmist said, when the flood waters of disaster and disease would have destroyed us, here's your shout, if it had not been for the Lord who was on our side, now let Israel say, every weapon that was formed, he did not let it prosper. It was around our house, but it did not destroy us. It was down at the school, but it didn't touch our lives. People around us lost everything, but the Lord sustained us in the middle of it. And here's your shout. Now let Israel say, if it had not been for the Lord who was on our side, where would we be? And if you know that it was the Lord, you ought to open up your mouth and say, thank God for Jesus. Woo! Yeah. Look at the testimony of the keeping power of God. That in this pandemic, millions of people have lost their lives. But here we are in the sanctuary, breathing easy. There's some stuff we want him to change. There is some stuff we want God to do. There is some stuff that we wish was over. But I'm trying to tell you that it would have been worse if it had not been for the Lord who was on our side. All right. Y'all sit down. This last thing, we're gonna go. We gotta do communion. I just want you to take that with you. I gotta show you one more thing. He shows us God's protection from human enemies, God's deliverance from natural emergencies. Here's the last one that really blessed me. But then he encouraged them to celebrate the blessing, y'all, of the Lord's mercies. Lord have mercy. Look at verse 6. Look at verse 6. Blessed be the Lord. First of all, that
really is amazing, because he just got through telling us about all the stuff they've been through, all the stuff that has happened, and he starts off the verse by literally saying, praise the Lord.
See, you got to understand something, that whenever you come on the other side of something, or whenever you are surviving something, that even though you may not like it, the fact that you can praise it means you're still alive. So when they get to verse 6, he says, blessed be the Lord, look what he says, who hath not given us as prey to their teeth. Now, I'm going to give you this and I'm going to go, because I've been up here too long. Now, verses 2 through 5, the text talks about some of the things that the Lord delivered them out of after it happened. But in verse 6, the psalmist says that there are some things that God delivered them from because God did not let it happen. I'm going to give it to you again. Verse 2 through 5, there were some things that God delivered them from that they saw. But when they got to verse 6, there were some things that God delivered them from that they never got a chance to see. Give it to you this way. He protects us from danger seen and unseen. He says, blessed be the Lord who hath not given us as prey to their teeth. Now, here's all the psalmist is trying to show us. All he's trying to let us see is that God has more than one way to deliver. I need you to understand that, because somebody's praying, you telling God how to do it, but I need to encourage you with what the psalmist says, that God has more than one way to deliver. He can let it happen and then get you out, but he can also stop it before it ever gets started. Just ask Daniel. He'll let them throw you in the lion's den, but then he'll take the appetite away from the lions. I believe the Hebrew boys are testifying that he'll let them throw you in the fire, but then will make you fireproof and get in there with you. I need somebody to know that he can bring low money up, but he can also bring high bills down. He can heal you with a miracle, but he can also heal you through medicine. All he's trying to tell you is that God has more than one way to deliver. Look at verse 7. I got to go. Look what he said. I want you to see the imagery here. Because I got all the way down here, y'all. And I heard on Sunday school this morning, just blessed me. I said, at first I said, we're going to stop there. But I heard on Sunday school, y'all was talking about traps and snares. I want you to see the imagery that he uses, because it brought it all together for me. Look what verse 7 says. Our soul is escaped as a bird out of the snare of the fowlers. The snare is broken and we are escaped. Y'all see that? Now, this word snare here means trap. And the word fowler literally means fowl hunter or bird hunter. The word fowl is the word that's used many times in the Bible for bird. And so the snare is the trap. Fowler is the fowl hunter or the bird. Now, I want you to remember, y'all, that in that day, they were not hunting for sport, but they hunted to survive. Y'all gonna get it. So the intention of the hunters was always to consume whatever they caught. Okay, stay with me. Stay with me. But the psalmist says, y'all, that we have escaped from the trap of the hunter. Y'all see that? But in order, y'all, to escape from it, that means that you first had to be caught in it. I'm going to bring it back around, because somebody ain't missing. If the intention of the hunter was to consume whatever they caught, but the psalmist says that we escaped from the trap, would indicate that they were delivered from what they were caught in. And so here's the blessing that the psalmist is trying to relate to them. That even though we were caught, The Lord did not allow us to be consumed, because the Lord got us out. And I'm talking to somebody that can look back over your life and see that there were some times that you were caught, but you were not consumed. For it is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because his faith fail not. But look at how, I'm out of here. Look at how the psalmist encapsulates the verse. He says, our soul is escaped. Then at the end he says, and we are escaped. See, sometimes y'all know what it's like. Oh, look at it again. He says, our soul is escaped. He says, but we are escaped. Here's all that means. He said, I want to make sure that when y'all read this, Main Street Church of God in Christ, that you understand that we were delivered and our soul is escaped. But since the Lord destroyed the trap of the hunter, we still are escaped. Which means that the Lord set me free. And because I'm still in Christ, I'm still free. And if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. For who the Son sets free is free indeed. You ought to look at your neighbor and say, yeah, I'm free, I'm free, I'm free. I may be going through something, but I'm still free. Then he ends it. He said, I want y'all to know. He says, our help, Lord have mercy, is in the name, Lord have mercy, of the Lord who made heaven and earth. I said, God, all right, we out of here with this. I said, God, all right, why did you just say that their help is in the Lord? You said, our help is in the name of the Lord. And I'm going to make sure you know who I'm talking about. Who made heaven, Lord have mercy, and earth. He says, I want to make sure you understand who I am. Because some folk get it twisted. That's why when Moses went in, he said, who will I say sent me? Listen, you ain't got to tell him my whole name. Just say, I am. Because my resume speaks for itself. And if you don't know, now you know. He says, our help is in the name of the Lord. Here's my resume, who made heaven and earth. I said, well, God, I get it, but why wouldn't you just say that their help was in the Lord? He says, very simple. He says, because sometimes, Lord, have, just like the men on the mountain, when the blizzard come and you can't see, sometimes you can't see God, but you can still call my name. Your help is in the name of the Lord. And whenever you're going through stuff, you ought to just open up your mouth and say his name. What's his name? Everybody stand, everybody stand, everybody stand, everybody stand. My next prayer for those, anybody who's listening to me online or in the building, if you have not received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, right now is the time, the day that you hear his voice, harden not your heart. Because the only way that we can ensure that the Lord is on your side is if you are his. I say it all the time, that those who say that we're all God's children, and that ain't true. We all God's creation, but we ain't all God's children. Because the Bible says, to him that have believed on him, he has given them power to become sons. So even though he made all of us, you're not his child until you accept him as your Lord and Savior. And I'm praying that right now, that you would make the decision no longer to try to climb without being a child. Lord have mercy. You need the strength of God to live this life. I'm trying to tell y'all, if you look around the world right now, everything that's going on, I keep telling y'all, a third of the nation right now is on fire. Over 700,000 people in America have died from COVID-19. Crazy stuff happening everywhere. Shootings all over the place in the schools, and just crazy stuff happening all over the place. And there are some people, and it's sad, it's so sad, that are hoping for the world to get better. But if you read your Bible, he already told us that this world is not our home. But we just pilgrims passing through. And that one day this entire world is going to be destroyed by fire. And our responsibility is to get everybody into the ark of safety so that they're not destroyed with this earth. So right now, I want somebody who has not received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I want you to make that decision right now. The Bible tells us in Romans chapter 10, verse 9, that if thou wilt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, shall believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. You want to make that decision today, I want you to repeat after me. Lord Jesus, I am a sinner, but I believe that you are the Son of God. I believe that you came, you lived, you died, that you rose again with all power in your hand. And I believe that right now, if I receive you into my heart, that I'll have a right to the tree of life. So right now, I ask you to come into my heart. Forgive me of all of my sins. Be my Lord and my Savior, and I will be your child. And right now, by faith, I receive you, and I am saved. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Put your hands together for those who have now joined the body of Christ. And if by chance you gave your life to the Lord today, we want to know who you are. We want you to connect with us. Put that in the comment section. I received Jesus. We want to help you achieve your goals in God. We are a loving family of believers. We're in this world, but we are not of this world. Also, if the Lord has impressed upon your heart to be a member of the Main Street Church of God in Christ, put that in the comment section also. I want to be a member. But if by chance you say, well, I don't want to put all my business in the comment section, that's fine. Use that link. Click to connect. And you'll be connected to a secure secure platform to allow you to give your information to our intake team, and someone will reach out to you. Also, at this time, we're preparing our hearts to give. And we thank God because he has given seed to the sower. We thank God that 10% of our increase is the tithe. Our tithe we owe. And our offering we sow. So I thank God for all of you who are diligent and who are consistent in your giving, because you have allowed us to do amazing things in ministry. And we're doing our part to make sure that we are meeting the needs of our congregation, the needs we know about, the best we know how. And we even continue to expand ministry to get out this great gospel. So if you want to give and sow today online, I want you to use that link. Click to give and you'll be connected to our online giving platform, Givelify. You'll be able to sow seed directly into ministry. And if you want to give via Cash App online or in the sanctuary, use the cash tag $ Main Street COGIC and you'll be able to sow seed directly into ministry. And even to our online audience, we thank you all, and we will see you Wednesday night for Bible study. Main Street, let's tell our online audience, we'll see you later.